Good evening, everyone. If you have a Bible or a device, Psalm chapter 42, the book of Psalms chapter 42, and if you're willing and able, will you stand with me for the reading of God's word? In tradition, we stand to honor the scripture with our body, but we also stand because the scripture is authoritative and the interpretation is not. So we stand for the scripture reading, and we sit for the interpretation because we believe God's word is authoritative. Psalm chapter 42, verse 1, the psalmist writes, "Just as the deer longs for springs of water, so my very being longs for you, O God. My being thirsted for the living God. When shall I come and appear to the face of God? My tears became my food day and night, while it was said to me day after day, quote, 'Where is your God?' End quote. These things I remembered, and I poured out my being upon me, because I shall proceed to a place of a marvelous tent, as far as the house of God, with a sound of rejoicing and acknowledging, a noise of one who is feasting. Why are you deeply grieved, O my being? Why are you throwing me into confusion? Hope in God, because I shall acknowledge him. My God is the deliverance of my face. My being, it was troubled at myself. Therefore, I shall remember you from the land of Jordan and Heremanim, from a small mountain. Deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfalls. All your surges and your billows passed over me. By day, the Lord will command his mercy, and at night, an ode is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I will say to my God, 'My supporter you are. Wherefore did you forget me? Why must I walk around sullenly as the enemy oppresses me? As my oppressors crushed my bones, they insulted me, while they say to me day after day, quote, "Where is your God?" end quote. Why are you deeply grieved, O my being? Why are you throwing me into confusion? Hope in God, because I shall acknowledge him. My God is the deliverance of my face." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You can be seated. Well, friends, it is my privilege tonight to introduce our speaker and to interview our speaker. Hello. I have the privilege of interviewing Brianna Matchett tonight. Bree, why don't you come up? Bree is a counseling therapist here in Calgary. Brianna Matchett, MCCCC, counselor at Garden Counseling Services. My wife, the mother of my children. And I have the privilege not of being your speaker tonight, but of being the one who interviews your speaker tonight. So welcome, Bree, just one more time as she comes. We're privileged to have Bree. Bree is, as many of the speakers in this series have been, a professional or a working professional in the field of counseling, psychology, and therapy. And Bree's been doing this for several years now, 5+ years of experience of working with clients, a post-degree, and she continues to supervise new therapists and even teach courses in relation to counseling. So we're privileged to have her here tonight, that she'd give us some of her time, rather. So I want to begin, if you'll allow me, with a little bit of a recap from where we've been. A little bit of a recap from where we've been with a few questions. We've been in the Sound Mind series for several weeks now, but we've had some breaks in between. So if you'll allow me, I'd like to throw out some stuff that we've done already. We started the series talking about the sort of biopsychosocial model of therapy. I'm wondering, when you work with clients, how does the biopsychosocial model fit into your work generally as you work with them?
It is a big part of my work with clients. I consider psychology and the mind a big part of counseling, but definitely just a piece of it, because we're holistic people. So it's important to consider biology, social relationships, and everything connected with that. And then also the spiritual side of things, which even when clients come in who are not connected spiritually or don't want faith-based counseling, I'm very transparent that that's a part of who I am and a part of how I function, and so can set that aside in terms of the types of conversations we have, but it's still a big piece of how I see people and how I work with people.
It's really helpful. So we started with that. We started talking about the biopsychosocial model, and then we moved to talking about anxiety and depression. And so I'm wondering, maybe just off the cuff, if you have a client who comes in to see you who's experienced anxiety or depression, what's maybe like a core piece of advice that you'd give them? What's something that you find yourself repeating again and again with clients who come to see you?
I'll often start by explaining how anxiety functions as alarm and talk about how just generally with emotions, they're telling us something. And so although often we can be afraid or nervous of a feeling we have, feelings to compound the feelings, the anxiety is just telling us something. And so our role and responsibility with that feeling is to figure out what it's telling us. And that's sometimes the reason people come to counseling, because they need another perspective in order to try to figure out what that anxiety is connected to. It's not always obvious, hence the feeling of anxiety.
Yeah, that's really helpful. I know many of us in the room, I want to ask for a show of hands tonight, have experienced something like anxiety or depression before. And I think the description of it being an alarm system kind of fits, doesn't it? Like an alarm is going off inside of you that you need to sort of figure out what's going on. I think that's really helpful. And then most recently, we talked about coping mechanisms that sort of play a positive and negative role in our lives. I'm just wondering, what role do coping mechanisms play kind of in our overall health as human beings?
I think in lots of ways they can take the pressure off a feeling for a while. So going for a walk, spending time with a friend when you have an intense emotional response to something can actually be really helpful. We can't always face the emotion right away. We can't always sit with the feeling right away. Sometimes taking the pressure off and going and doing something else is really helpful, coping. But then in other ways, it can be really negative if instead we run away and avoid and never face what we're experiencing and repress or shut down, as well as turn to what are typically called negative coping strategies, which are often connected to feeling happy and feeling good instead of facing what's uncomfortable and hard.
Happiness, I'm unfamiliar. Okay, so we started the series with the biopsychosocial model. We moved to anxiety and depression. We had time with coping mechanisms. And now tonight, you want to chat to us a little bit about self-talk.
Yes.
So let's just begin with what is self-talk and maybe a description of maybe the experience of self-talk that any one of us have in the room.
Mm-hmm. So self-talk is an internal dialogue. This is the APA definition, so the American Psychological Association. An internal dialogue in which an individual utters phrases or sentences to themselves. Another resource that I used is from Psychology Today. So your inner voice is combining conscious thoughts and unconscious beliefs or biases to interpret and process daily experiences. So essentially all it means is we all experience self-talk. We talk to ourselves, we have an internal voice, an internal process. We may not always identify what the distinctive thought is, but there are thoughts that prompt us to certain behaviors. There are thoughts that prompt certain feelings. Self-talk can be supportive and bolster our confidence. If we're nervous about something, going into a situation, telling ourselves, I can do this. I'm going to be okay. I'm prepared. I spent time on this. I can do it.
Aubrey's self-talk for tonight. Come on, y'all.
Yeah. Or it becomes self-defeating. I'm an idiot, I can't do anything right. I'm stupid, I can't face this. I'm so nervous, I'm gonna make a complete fool of myself. It can be either of those, and depending on the type of self-talk, it's going to amplify the types of feelings we have and often influence what we do or don't do.
Great, so self-talk basically at the core is just kind of talking to ourselves about ourselves, is that right?
Yes.
Not in a crazy way, in a normal way.
Yeah, and, like, and about situations and people.
We've all encountered people, ourselves included, muttering to ourselves. Have you ever put your AirPods in just so you could talk to yourself while you're walking around? I know you have. I see you guys. I know you're not on the phone. I know you're just talking out loud about stuff you want to talk about. I see you. I know what you're doing. So basically what you're saying is a kind of internal dialogue that relates to the way we experience the world around us. But I think you're alluding to the fact that that's kind of based on previous experiences, right? So we have built-in self-talk that's based on our family of origin or trauma we experienced, et cetera. Can you speak to that maybe a little bit?
Mm-hmm. So often I'll talk with clients about having an inner critic, which is often connected to negative voices, negative experiences, negative people that we've kind of had in life. And so all of those things contribute to those self-defeating patterns of thoughts and behaviors. And just general experiences, like whatever our family of origin relationships are, that tells us how we can expect to interact with people in the future. If we can trust people, if we should be suspect based on our core family relationships. All of those things communicate something to us and our person, and is often demonstrated in the way that we talk to ourselves.
Great. So I hear you saying there's like a kind of a spectrum of self-talk. So there's like positive ways to self-talk. I am capable. I can do it. Dwight Schrute, you will get this promotion, that type of deal. And then there's like the negative end of the spectrum of like, I won't get it, I'm terrible, I'm no good, I'm this sort of thing. And then there's neutral questions that sort of probably exist somewhere in the middle of self-examination. I think that's why you were motivated to choose Psalm 42 for us tonight as our primary teaching text. Can you talk to us maybe a little bit about why you would choose Psalm 42 as a sort of key text to show where self-talk appears in Scripture?
Yeah, I mean, I personally identify a lot with the Psalms. I've found myself gravitating towards the Psalms just generally in life, because I don't know if any of you can resonate with this, but it's easy to find ourselves in the Psalm. It's written in first person. We don't necessarily know who each Psalm was written by, and it's not really framed in a way that kind of prompts us to necessarily go there. And lots of these words can be, you know, echoed by us in particular moments. They can become our prayer. They can become our dialogue. Even some of the songs we sing could be called self-talk, whether that's neutral, you know, reminders of things can be neutral self-talk.
I was thinking that tonight, actually, just as we're singing the miracles on the way, you know, like this is a kind of self-talk for all of us, actually. As we sing, we're sort of re-narrating something within ourselves about kind of what's coming and what we expect and how we feel inside of ourselves. I also love what you're saying. You know, scholars of the Hebrew Bible have talked really often, actually, about the eye of the Psalter. So like when we read the Psalms in particular and we read, I or me or my, why so downcast, oh my soul, we can actually identify quite clearly with this sort of rhetoric that we find ourselves in the Psalms in really particular kinds of ways, which I'm assuming, again, is why you chose Psalm 42.
Yeah, part of why I chose that. And then also the connection with Jesus in Gethsemane, which I think you had mentioned as I brought up Psalm 42.
Yeah, so Psalm 42 follows this really interesting narrative I'm sure you've noticed as we were reading it together tonight. The psalmist says twice, actually, by refrain, why so downcast, O my being, or my soul, maybe your translation says, and why are you throwing me into confusion? Anyone ask yourself that question? Yeah. Why do I feel this way? Why do I feel so down? What's going on inside of me? You know, Bree mentioned that she wanted to do Psalm 42, and I thought it was actually really interesting because we are in Holy Week, and part of Holy Week is Jesus finding himself in Gethsemane. And if you actually read Matthew's narration of the Gethsemane event, by the way, if I were writing a gospel and I wanted to give credibility to the person of Jesus, I would not include a Gethsemane story. Are you with me? If you want to know something about the humanity of Jesus, just look at the Gethsemane story. But as he goes into the garden, the sort of olive press moment, Jesus says, why so downcast, O my soul? Why are you so grieved? He actually quotes Psalm 42 as a type of self-talk. And so I think it's helpful for us to see here, and then I'll punt back to you, that the Psalms themselves and Jesus himself evidences a kind of self-talk. Like what we're talking about tonight, while it's rooted in psychology and modern forms of therapy, it's as old as our scriptures, this process of actually trying to interrogate our emotions and our feelings and our processes. Is there more you'd want to say about Psalm 42 before we move on?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, even just to kind of go through it, the reminders that are being offered by the psalmist, which I wonder if it's current or past. My being thirsted for the living God, which sounds past, and I think that that's part of self-talk, reminding us who we've been, even when we don't feel that way, in particularly positive ways. You know, and asking, where is your God? interesting wording. Not where is my God, where is your God? Almost a dialogue, you know, a dialogue with self. These things I remembered and poured out my being upon me. So a reflection of the past. What have I done in the past that's been good and helpful and connected me to God? Or, you know, been a part of my feelings or process. I shall proceed to a place of a marvelous tent as far as the house of God. You know, the action, the movement towards positive things, regardless of how we feel. Rejoicing, acknowledging, feasting. And yet, back to the question, why are you deeply grieved? Why are you throwing me into confusion? So our feelings don't always make sense. Our process doesn't always make sense. We can't always understand what's going on. And then, you know, the psalmist is almost telling themselves, hope in God. You know, and answering maybe, why should I hope in God? Because I shall acknowledge him. He is the deliverance of my face. And then, again, like coming back to you, reflecting on, you know, what these feelings could be connected to, what they are connected to, being troubled with myself, trying to remember God again, you know, deep calls to deep, you know, maybe feeling in a deep space, a pit, unable to get out, and yet reminding themselves of God and how God has been present, even if God doesn't feel present in the current circumstances. And then asking God questions, which I think is so helpful. My supporter you are, wherefore did you forget me? Why must I walk about sullenly as the enemy oppresses me? Again, where is your God? And then again, another question. But then I think with lots of the Psalms, the psalmist moves towards an encouragement, not always, hope in God, because I shall acknowledge him. My God is the deliverance of my face. So once again, back to why am I grieved? Why am I being thrown in confusion? Still no answer, but I will hope in God.
Yeah, thanks. You know, John Calvin once said of the Psalms that the Psalms are the anatomy of a human soul. And what Calvin meant by this comment in his introduction to the Psalter is that there's not an emotion that you can experience as a person, not a feeling you've had that you won't find in the Psalms. Have you noticed this? Like, you can actually find all of yourself in the Psalms. And in that process, I think here too, all of yourself in the Psalms in the sense of asking, man, why do I feel this way? What's going on inside of me? And maybe I'll throw this text up. Just let me read it for you. This is the Gethsemane moment. This is Jesus. This is in Matthew's gospel. Jesus came to them to an area called Gethsemane, and he said to his apprentices, sit here. Well, departing, I'll go pray over there. And taking Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to grieve and be discomforted. Feel that often. Then he said to them, my being is deeply grieved to the point of death. This is a direct citation from Psalm 42. And so even with Jesus, we see self-talk. And I think this is really normalizing for me. I don't know if, is it normalizing for you? Are you with me? This notion that like these feelings and experiences of being deeply grieved, not only do we see it in the Psalms, but we actually see it in our rabbi and redeemer, Jesus himself. And so as we think of self-talk then, one of the primary therapies that relates to self-talk, one of the most proven forms of therapy, many of you will know this, the most proven form of therapy is exposure therapy. Did you know this? If you have a fear or a problem, one of the greatest, most effective methods is to expose yourself to the fear and the problem. With responsibility, please, by the way, let's just be clear about that. I'm not asking you to go and, you know, without a rope, climb a cliff. Please don't do that. But what I am saying is the most effective form of therapy is a type of exposure therapy, but the second most proven form of therapy is cognitive behavioral therapy, because it's something that you can do even to yourself. So you can talk to us about cognitive behavioral therapy for a moment. What is it? Why is it valuable?
Cognitive behavioral therapy looks at the connection between thoughts, feeling, and behavior. So it's based on this, you know, concept, idea, what we think impacts how we feel and what we do, and what we do impacts what we think and how we feel. And finally, as you would guess, it comes around to what we feel impacts how we think and what we do.
So I think we have a diagram. Maybe we can throw up the diagram for a moment. This might help illustrate. Okay, so you think of it this way, this triangle?
Yes.
Talk to us a little bit about this triangle and why it is useful for all of our lives. To quote Dwight Schrute, the pyramid, the strongest shape within which you can fit all the other shapes.
Thank you.
Please.
So with this diagram, the idea, at least in using it for ourselves, but also in therapy, is to categorize, to place your thoughts, your feelings, and your action. And the idea, at least with cognitive behavioral therapy, is that we don't want to we don't want to be led by our feelings. We want to understand our feelings, but not necessarily make our decisions from the place of feelings. So often you'll see arrows pointing from one to the other, indicating, as you would guess, that they're all connected. But the idea of cognitive behavioral therapy is that we want to examine thoughts and change our thoughts as well as change our actions so that it influences our feeling. Because the idea is we don't have control over what we feel, but we can change thought patterns as well as behaviors, which will influence our feelings.
Okay, so all of these are connected then. So, you know, some people will often talk about how if I'm feeling down, maybe I go for a walk, or maybe I go to the gym. Anybody? Not me, but like I hear people do that. Or maybe it's I have thoughts that are negative, and so I'm gonna interrogate my feelings or again, change something about my behavior. So what you're saying then is they're all connected in this way. Like I might act a certain way to influence how I feel or what I'm thinking, or I might try to sort of maybe move my feelings in a direction to shape the way that I think. So again, we're back to that sort of biopsychosocial of we're holistic creatures who act and think and feel, and all of those things are connected. Is that right?
Yeah.
I think this flies in the face of certain things that we think of culturally often, though, right? Like, I know with Christians often I hear language of like, well, I don't want to do it if I don't feel it, because that wouldn't be right. I wouldn't want to go and pray if I don't feel like it, though, because then I'd be a hypocrite or something. But what it sounds like you're saying is that if I don't feel like it or I feel down about it, maybe the thing I should do is actually go do it or ask myself questions about why I don't want to do it. Is that what you're suggesting?
Mm-hmm. And often one of those things, thoughts or action, will feel easier to us, which in that sense, that one's okay. Starting with thoughts or feelings, but they're both difficult. There's going to be something that we don't want to do. But the whole idea of cognitive behavioral therapy is the thing that's best for us is often not the thing that feels good or feels right in the moment.
So tell us about then maybe like three or four ways that we can engage this process that are going to be helpful. So we're thinking about how we're holistic creatures. We can act and behave. We feel and we think. And those are all interconnected. They can influence each other. So what are some strategies then really practically that we can employ that you would recommend to clients that are actually utilizing this process of cognitive behavioral therapy?
Emotional regulation is one of them, which is a person's ability to effectively manage and respond to an emotional experience. So this connects to what I was saying earlier about the positive impact of coping strategies. Taking a break from something and coming back can be part of emotional regulation. So emotional regulation is connected more so to feelings, but again, still connected with all three pieces.
You know, one of my experiences with followers of Jesus in the West, I don't know if this is you, maybe you resonate with this experience. I don't think we've done a very good job discipling our emotions, learning how to operate. Like, God has robust emotions. When you read scripture, it's very clear God is an emotional being. Are you with me? And we're made in his image, so we are also very emotional beings. And there's something about emotional regulation or learning to navigate emotions well that I feel like we've missed in the church in the West. You know this as well as I do. We live with a 2.5-year-old. Anybody else? No? Maybe one day though, right? You might meet that lucky someone tonight. And here's what I know about my 2.5-year-old that might actually be similar to some people in the room tonight, is she has no idea how to regulate her emotions. And so what happens is something like, I don't want to play Frozen anymore on our stereo, and like I fell and broke my arm gets the same emotional reaction. And you're like, that can't be right. That's pretty unregulated, right? And so there's a degree to which I think early on, many of us, if you're like me in my family of origin, you sort of maybe miss the boat on how we manage emotions well, how we do emotions well. And so that's kind of what you're getting at, right? Learning to process emotions properly, to recognize that an emotion itself is not moral. It's just something that emerges within our bodies that we then have an opportunity to interrogate and learn to regulate. But then you would move to something like Socratic questioning, right? Can you tell us about the kinds of questions we might ask ourselves in a situation like this?
Yeah, I mean, before we move to that, I just did want to say one last thing about emotional regulation, which was trying to identify the exact emotion you're experiencing. So like Cody had said, we can find a breadth of emotion in the Psalms, all emotion. Often part of our misunderstanding of ourselves and emotion is not knowing what we're feeling. So one of the tools that you can literally just Google and get thousands of them is the feeling wheel, which I think one of my encouragements around emotional regulation is broadening your vocabulary around your emotions. If you can understand them better, you can explain them better and work yourself kind of through that process.
Yeah, I think that's helpful. So like I grew up in a really traumatic, broken family home situation, like many of you in the room, serious and significant trauma. And for me as an adult, and this is actually pretty common among males, most of my ability to interpret emotion is just anger. So the only emotion I have is being angry. And for others in the room, most of your emotional energy gets kind of filtered through one emotion. But part of that is because we haven't discipled our emotions. We haven't learned that there's actually a breadth of emotions that might fall under the umbrella of something like anger. And so this has been really helpful for me, even something like an emotions wheel or a chart. You can Google them. They're available, like Bree said. It's worth getting your hands on to try to, as Bree said, expand your vocabulary in relation to emotions. It's really helpful. Talk to us about questions.
Yeah. So questioning our thoughts, it becomes really helpful.
So we shouldn't just act on every thought we have.
Correct.
Helpful.
And this is where that we come back to the triangle. If we reflect on the actions we want to take and the person we want to be, that will also contribute to asking questions about our thoughts, because our thoughts don't always align with who we want to be or become or even following Jesus. And so if we act on every thought, you know, we might find ourselves in situations that we don't actually want to be in, and this is, again, back to feelings, but what feels good in the moment or what feels easy is often not the thing that aligns with our value system or is centered around growth and change, which is actually quite challenging and difficult and doesn't often promote lots of positive feelings initially. So the questions, or Socratic questions, are designed to encourage us to discover answers by engaging in just more critical thinking. There are six types of Socratic questions. So questions aim to clarify thinking, probe assumptions, establish evidence, explore alternative perspectives, investigate implications, and to question the question.
That's helpful. So like what we see in Psalm 42 then is exactly this. It's the question, right? Like, why do I feel this way? I'm going to probe assumptions, maybe look for evidence. Why do I feel this way? Hey, God is good to you. Why would you feel this way? Why so downcast, oh my soul, this type of deal. So that's questions. And then three, you have shifting perception. So tell me about what you mean by that. So we're moving from kind of learning to establish language and understanding of our emotions, and then we're moving to asking ourselves certain types of questions, and then you have shifting our perception. What do you mean by that?
So that's connected to family of origin, but also just our experiences of people and the stories we tell ourselves to make sense of things. We all tell ourselves stories about how the world functions, about how people functions, about how things are going to happen to us and for us and from us. And that all is connected to our perception. So one of the things I'll often say to clients, particularly couples, but is true for everyone, is that there are multiple perceptions, but only one reality. And so looking into our perceptions and even confiding in other people about how we perceive a situation, what some of our self-talk is, gets us closer to reality. Because we ourselves, in isolation and seclusion with our thoughts, are not fully grounded in reality.
Yeah, it was the great mystic Thomas Merton who said, the greatest danger to our spiritual life is to be immersed in unreality. That it's actually really difficult to be tethered to what is true and real all the time. Are you with me? And so what we need then are people in our lives who can help us shift our perception or help us realize that we're not quite as tethered to reality as we might think. And then four, quite obviously in the triangle, you have alternating our activity. So just maybe say a word about that.
Yeah, that's more connected to, taking breaks, needing to step away from some of those thoughts, feelings, but also it can be connected to identifying a feeling and what we might need. So feeling lonely, maybe the best thing is not to sit there and to stew on your thoughts. Maybe getting out, meeting with a friend, or even just sitting in a busy coffee shop where there are other voices, other people, so you can shift, think about something else, as well as just positive things that we need to engage in, whether that's like exercise, eating well, which is not necessarily an activity, but a positive thing connected back to that biopsychosocial model. When we're lacking something, when we're missing something, we want to meet that need and see if it shifts how we feel.
Great. So first then, if anybody's taking notes tonight, you know, emotional regulation is number one. Number two, that we move to asking certain types of questions like we see in Psalm 42. Three is shifting our perception, so inviting others along in our spiritual journey. We are not designed to do life alone, yes? The diabolos, your enemy, is out there like a roaring lion seeking you to devour at this very moment. Being alone is not the way you want to do things. You will become increasingly untethered from God's reality. And so we need each other to do this life together. And then alternating activity. So actually moving ourselves from one situation to another, because it's actually in doing, believe it or not, that we can shape so much of the way that we think and feel. And that is so antithetical to the way Protestants in the West have come to think. So I really do want to push back on this and remind you, young friends in the room tonight, you need to understand one of the key imports of what Bree is here to talk about with us tonight is that when you're feeling down or you're struggling or you have anxiety or you feel like something's off inside of you, one of the greatest things that you can do is not say, once I feel better, I'll go worship, or once I feel better, I'll pray, or once I feel better, I'll get to the temple, but you actually just get up and go. It was yesterday, I think. I was feeling really tired, and I decided I was going to go to the gym. Yeah, I do it sometimes. Get over it. It's fine. And I was like really, you know that back and forth moment? Like I got my gym clothes on. I was like trying to motivate myself to go. We have a gym in our building. Like it's not, I got the runners on, and I got the short shorts on. And I'm like, I can do this. And I got the hat on. And I'm like, I can do this. And then I'm like, I can't do this. I think I'm just going to eat instead. You know, that feeling where like, who needs the gym when you can just eat some food, you know? And I literally, no joke, just had a whim of like, I can do this. And I ran out the door and downstairs. And I had to text Bree to say, I wasn't raptured or anything. I just like ran downstairs because I had a moment where like I knew I could get there. And I got there. And then I did the gym stuff that gym people do. You know what that's about. And here I am today, still alive. I did it. But it did shape the way that I felt, and I think that's integral. Thank you. I'm telling this story because I need more affirmation about my gym life. Thank you so much.
Protein.
Yes, whey protein, biceps, the gears, all the things. If you know what the gears are, you can Google it later, it's fine. You're welcome. Cross, that's a cult, and we're not gonna talk about that tonight. Nonetheless, I think it's really valuable here what Bree's saying. Like, CBT is the most proven form of therapy, apart from exposure therapy, that you can actually do on yourselves. Like, for every one of us in the room who's going to experience anxiety and depression and struggle in our lives, that actually, like, asking yourself questions is really important in the process. And getting yourself next to people who can help you see differently, who can say, actually, that's a really negative thought pattern that you've established that actually not rooted in reality at all. Or actually your friend that's going to text you, be like, we're hitting the gym, or we're going to pray, or whatever we're doing, and actually allowing your thoughts to motivate your actions, to motivate your feelings, because they're all interconnected. I guess I'd wonder if you had to summarize maybe all of cognitive behavioral therapy in like a word or a sentence, like if we were walking out of here with like, I know a little bit about CBT now, I know more about self-talk, what would be one word or kind of a phrase that you would want to give us that would be really helpful for what it is that we're trying to do when we participate in this process?
A common word I use is reframe, or reframing our thoughts, which is Socratic questioning, but maybe a simpler version, which is just, what am I missing? What's another way to think about this? And I often like to clarify, it's not about optimism or something like a super positive thought. It can be something really neutral. Instead of, I can't do this, the reframe is, maybe I can do this. Not I can do this, like I have to do this, but just contemplating an alternative. And this works with, yeah, any thought that we experience is reframing, changing, starting to change, starting to contemplate changing our thoughts. And then a sentence, part of this, so allowing, the process of self-talk allows us through emotional regulation, so through our feelings, into Socratic questioning, challenging our thinking, and alternating perception or behavior, so changing our behavior to reframe. And I'm not sure we really talked about this yet, but cognitive dissonance.
Yeah, that's really helpful. Again, I think of, we'll come to cognitive dissonance in just a second. I think again of Jesus in Gethsemane, and I think of this process of, I don't know if you've thought about this before, there's lots of things in the gospel narratives that I think we read by really quickly. Like most people who are cradle Christians, if you grew up hearing these stories, the danger for you is actually familiarity. Like you think you know the story, but you actually don't know it very well. And so you come back to these stories and you read them and you see details that maybe you've never really noticed before. I remember a couple years ago reading through this narrative of Jesus going into Gethsemane, and I was like, oh, Jesus is having a panic attack. Like, Jesus goes into Gethsemane, he can barely walk, he collapses onto the ground, and he starts asking himself talk-related questions. He quotes Psalm 42, like, why am I so grieved within me? What's going on? And it's almost like the ministry and mission of Jesus, everything that he's done and said and the realization of who he is, the Son of Man, is like catching up with his body. And he's having this sort of panic attack as he looks towards the cross and God's redemption. And then that sends him to prayer, of course. It's so interesting that the self-talk then motivates him towards prayer. But I think part of what's being worked out in our Socratic questioning and our emotional regulation, all these things, is we experience types of cognitive dissonance. So maybe we'll end here and then get to some case studies. Talk to us a little bit about cognitive dissonance.
So cognitive dissonance is two competing thoughts, essentially. I want to go to the gym. I don't want to go to the gym. Both can't stay there. You can't stay with two competing thoughts. You have to resolve to do one or the other at some point. You can stay there for a little bit, but at some point, either you decide, yeah, I really want to go to the gym and therefore I'm going, or yeah, who cares about the gym? I don't need that. Because cognitive dissonance creates a deep discomfort, at least the feeling that's attached with that. And you can't stay there, but it does, or should, or can, promote thinking about, what do I actually want? What do I really want here? And if, you know, this can connect to values. If what I really care about is health, how might going to the gym get me closer to that value or move in the direction of that value? So essentially, cognitive dissonance is two competing thoughts. You have to go with one. And the goal of it is to move towards, a lack of dissonance.
So that's really helpful then. So then Jesus enters into Gethsemane, and he's known for the entirety of the gospel that the Son of Man will be betrayed and handed over, and he will die, and after 3 days he will rise again. That Jesus knows he's going to the cross. I mean, he can say to his disciples, unless you deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me, you're not one of my apprentices. And yet, when he comes into the garden, he experiences a type of cognitive dissonance that says, yeah, I know that this is the direction of my ministry, but actually I kind of want to know if there's another way. Like, I know that's the directionality of all of this, but I have the dissonance of like, I don't want to do this. And so then he enters into a kind of self-talk in this moment. Mm-hmm. And then self-talk drives him towards prayer, where three times he prays the same prayer as his disciples are sleeping. That's really helpful. I'm gonna ask you all in a moment to group up, just so you know, I'm gonna give you forewarning here. I'm gonna invite you with the people around you to maybe talk together about some patterns and positive and negative of self-talk that you have and you've seen in your own life. But first, we're going to maybe tackle just a few examples to kind of get to prime the pump a little bit, if you will. And so let's use failure as an example first, okay? So sure. I fail a test. I try out for the team and I don't make it. I fail a class in university. I apply for a job, but I don't get the job. What's some of the self-talk that you see emerge in people? Let's go to the negative here when these types of things happen.
Probably one of the most common is I can't do anything right.
Right.
Which, again, so back to family of origin or just main like role models in our life often contribute to these situations. As young kids, what happened when you made a mistake? Usually kids don't just naturally gravitate towards negative self-talk, but they parrot and understand, you know, what they're told and how someone else interprets their experience. So maybe you have at some point, if you failed and the first piece of self-talk is, I can't do anything right, maybe that is something that you've heard from someone who was really important in your life, or something along those lines. It could have been, you're stupid, why did you fall, how could you not see that, all potentially contributing to, and this is where perception comes in, the perception of the event is, maybe I can't do anything right. Not that that was specifically what you were told.
Right, so we sort of take a failure moment in our lives. Anyone ever fail once or twice in your life at something? So we take failure moments, and for many of us, it seems like those key failure moments can then turn into self-talk that just wildly overgeneralizes, mm-hmm. right? So I have this failure, but then my self-talk becomes very general self-talk about I can't get anything right. So why bother doing the next thing? Why bother venture out? Because I'll just fail again and again and again. That's really helpful. So let's move then to experiencing a breakup. Not that anyone in the room has ever had one of those, am I right? Experiencing a breakup, really common thing that happens. Let's talk about a kind of overgeneralization or a kind of catastrophizing that attaches itself to a breakup.
Yeah, so the...
oh, no. Okay.
The catastrophizing can be, I'm never going to find as good of a person as X, or this was kind of the best person for me. There's no one else out there. Catastrophizing is also, I'm going to be alone forever. Mm. And the overgeneralization part is, yeah, I'm never going to find someone like this. There's no one else for me. Which has to be an overgeneralization. Look at everyone in this room.
Come
there
on,
are
look
other
around.
People out there.
There
Praise
have
God. To be other people out there, but we feel in that moment so stuck that this is it. All is a loss. This, you know, this time is gone. We're never going to find anyone this good.
Yeah, everyone leaves me. No one will ever love me. Mm-hmm. I'm ugly. I'm unlovable. I mean, we laugh, but like, if we all had access to each other's internal dialogue, I think that we would have a lot more empathy for each other. Mm-hmm. I think that, well, that is the very definition of empathy. We would actually feel what others feel. Like we don't have access to that, but we all have these types of negative self-talk. And I know that on the surface, something like this just seems so basic, but unless we, I think, can learn to challenge some of that self-talk, to actually narrate it and re-navigate it, then we're gonna keep feeling stuck as people. Let's go for a couple more. Let's say the death of a parent. Something you can't control, something that happens. I know this is my experience, 2015, my father passed away. What do you see with clients who are experiencing grief, the kind of maybe self-talk that they experience?
Often for people's first experience of grief just kind of shatters a trust in the world, a trust in people. And this can also tie back to a breakup. Sometimes a breakup is someone's first experience of grief. And I remember one time a client came in and I just really couldn't figure out why they were so stuck on their breakup until, you know, in prayer and contemplation, realizing that for them, this was not just a breakup. This was also the first loss that they had ever experienced. And it had just changed the way they saw the world, saw themselves, and were able to connect with people. And so with the death of a parent, it influences... It can at least create a lot of anxiety, something that you had not considered happening. Often we don't, I remember Cody and I were dating, and I don't know how this came up, but we were talking about death and loss, and someone I was really close to was my grandmother, kind of a second mother to me, grew up with her, spent a ton of time with her. She was my, you know, my biggest cheerleader. And I think Cody, you know, posed the question or even just brought it up, like, one day she won't be here. Like, what will
that be like? I sound so positive in this story, don't I?
Mm. Cody's a really optimistic guy.
So what are you gonna do when they die? Continue.
And I think I burst into tears because that possibility had never hit me before. In my mind, she was always gonna be there. She'd always been there for me. You know, she was just gonna be a constant presence in my life. And so that, even that thinking about it was so earth-shattering. So then experiencing the death of a parent, the death of a grandparent, an initial breakup, just kind of changes everything and can create an underlying anxiety in the way we go about the world. If this thing happened that I never fathomed could happen, what else could happen? Is everyone in my life gonna die? And then if someone else in proximity does die, we kind of latch on to that as evidence to suggest that, yes, everyone is going to, which, yes, eventually everyone will pass away, but
so my question did make sense, actually, just to defend myself a little bit.
Everyone does die, but, you know, when you live with that catastrophizing thought, what if, and then everyone you meet or every close person to you, there's now this attachment of fear to that individual that they're next.
I'll kick back to you in a second for the last word before we go into groups. Let me just say a couple things. Yeah, I think everyone leaves, no one loves me. Can I really trust people? No one listens to me. No one ever does anything for me. What if bad things keep happening? You know, maybe you lose your job and your self-talk is, I'm gonna lose everything and end up on the streets. So I'm gonna share some of my negative self-talk and then maybe I'll invite you to share a little bit of yours. I think in my life, some of the most common thread of self-talk in my life has been, I can't trust people. People are not trustworthy. Don't lean on people because at the end of the day, they won't really be there anymore. This, again, emerges for me out of my own trauma and sort of my own family of origin issues to feel like, well, actually, if you lean and you learn to live leaning this way, what you'll realize one day is that person will not be there for you. And so part of the re-narration of my self-talk, not only in relation to people around me, but also in relation to God, has had to be again and again and again that actually God is here. God is there. God can be leaned on. But more than that, my family and my friends and those who I choose to bring in close to me, that they can be leaned on. But if I'm honest, I still feel this negative self-talk creep up in me all the time. And so I'll invite you to share yours with somebody. So I figured I'd share mine. Do you want to have the last word on maybe some negative self-talk throughout the course of sort of your life, Bree?
Sure. So, I mean, the first one that comes to mind is that thought, I'm not good enough or I'll never be good enough. And for a long time, I don't think I really identified where it was coming from or why it was there, because no one had ever told me that. In fact, I think close people in my life had said, you know, none of us will be as hard on you as you are on yourself, which, again, didn't make sense. And now that I know what I know about how these things form, you know, being able to look back and see that my perception of events played a large role, but that it was because I didn't understand a lot of the decisions being carried out in my family, and the response was just, well, this is how we do it. And when I wanted to do something different or be someone different, it wasn't explicitly discouraged, but there was like this implication that I should be doing something different. You know, even pursuing education. No one else was doing that. It wasn't told to me not to do that. But when everyone else was pursuing something different and I wasn't being asked about education or educational pursuits, and I was asked about these other things that I wasn't doing, the emphasis was on, these are the important things, you're not doing them, hence contributing to that self-talk of, I'm not good enough.
It's really helpful. So now in groups, I'm going to ask you, and we'll transition to do a sort of live Q&R after this discussion time. So we'll do a bit of a transition here also. But I'm wondering if you'd be willing to share maybe with one or two people around you, somebody you came with, maybe somebody you trust. Let's go negative. What are some negative patterns of self-talk that you have in your life? And maybe what are strategies that you've employed to combat against those, overcome those? Go.
Wanted to share with us how you can connect to Garden Counseling. You got a website or something like that?
Yeah, so if you're looking for counseling, whether you want to work with me specifically or someone else, I can connect you. My website is www.gardencounseling.ca. There's the opportunity there to book a consultation with me. Again, the consultation can be about working with me specifically or kind of sharing your concerns and what's come up for you. And I'm happy to provide a couple different therapists in the city that can help specifically with your concerns. It does not have to be me. I am just very passionate about having people connected to the resources and help that they need.
So come on.
Feel free to reach out.
Amazing, amazing. We love you, Tehillah. Again, we want to see each and every one of us come into whole beings and healthy. So again, thanks for joining us in this series. We love you. We'll see you next week for our Saints series.